Hello everyone, welcome to our talk, The Probable Security of Ed25519, Theory and Practice. Nowadays, one of the most popular digital signature schemes is EDDSA. By virtue of high efficiency, the ED2559 instantiation has been widely deployed in various practical protocols. However, it turns out that the implementations differ substantially and the devil is in the details. Among them, three of the most significant ones are the original ED2559 and its IETF and libpseudonym variants. In this talk, we focus on four topics around ED2519. First, we explore the differences between these three implementations, the ED2519 original, IETF, and the libpseudonym versions, and figure out the impacts of the differences on their security guarantees. The next topic is related to unforgeability. Surprisingly, since the release of ED2519, no proof for unforgeability has ever been given for any ED2519 variant. In our paper, we close this gap by providing the first proof. Moreover, in some applications such as SSH, the underlying ED2519 scheme is even assumed to be strong unforgeable. The third topic in our paper is to investigate the strong unforgeability for each of these three variants. Finally, let's have a close look at the resilience to key substitution attacks, which are outside the traditional notions but have great significance for practical usage. Now we start to recall the basic definition of digital signature. Upon a signing key SK and a message M, the signer Alice can execute the signing algorithm to produce a signature sigma and send both message and a signature to the verifier Bob. Upon the corresponding verification key and the transcript received from Alice, Bob is expected to pass this verification by outputting the Boolean value true. In the unforgeability experiments, the sender Alice is simulated by a sending oracle that inputs a message M and outputs a real signature sigma. The adversary Eve has access to such sending oracle and finally outputs a pair of message and signature. The existential unforgeability under chosen message attacks, we say unforgeability for short, requires a verification algorithm executed by Bob to output false if the forged message M prime is unequal to any message M that has been queried to the sending oracle. The strong unforgeability requires Bob to reject any forged message signature pair, which is unequal to any pair derived from the interaction between Eve and the sending oracle. In particular, Eve can win the strong unforgeability experiment by forging a new signature sigma prime for a message M prime equals M that has already been queried. To investigate the unforgeability of ED25519, we first recall its basic construction. The ED25519 is designed on the twisted Edwards curve, TED2519. Regarding this curve, there are two important points. The one is the point at infinity O, which equals 0 times P for all points P on TED2519. The other is the selected base point B with order L. Here, the order of point B denoted by the absolute value defines the smallest positive integer n such that n times b equals the point at infinity. The ED2519 original consists of three algorithms. The key generation algorithm inputs public parameter and samples a key with length 256 bits. Next, it derives a 512 bits long value h by applying a hash function to this key. Then, it derives S from the second 256 bits of H and computes A equals SB. Here, This value A is the verification key and the sampled key is the signing key. The signing algorithm imposes a secret key K and a message M. The signer first recomputes the value H and S as in the key generation algorithm. Then it derives a value R from the message M and the first 256 bits of H. Finally, it computes big R equals small r times B, and big S equals small r plus hash of big R big A M times S, the modulus L, and outputs big R and big S as signature. The verification algorithm upon verification key A, a message M, a signature sigma, denoted by a pair of R, S, first checks whether points big R and A both are on the curve TED2519. Next, it checks whether S is 256 bits long. Finally, it checks whether the equation 8 times S times B equals 8 times big R plus 8 times hash of big R, A, M times A holds. And outputs true if all checks succeed, and false otherwise. In our paper, we formally proved that the basic paradigm of ED2519 is unforgeable. This indicates that the original ATF and the libpseudonym versions all are UFCMA secure. Regarding strong unforgeability, the case becomes different. When queries sending oracle on message M for signature R, S, the adversary can forge a new signature upon the same message M by replacing S by S prime, which equals S plus L. It's straightforward that the first and third checks are passed because the point R and A both are honestly generated, and the base point B has order L. Then, the adversary runs if S prime is 256 bits long, which occurs with non-negligible probability, and indicates that ED2519 original is not strong unforgeable. However, the IETF and the libpseudonym versions additionally involve the bound checking. In addition to the signature validation check, these two versions also ensure the value S in the range from 0 to L minus 1. Hence, we can observe that ED2519 original differs from IETF and the libpseudonym versions in bound checking. While the original version checks whether S is 256 bits long, the IETF and the libpseudonym versions check whether S is in the range from 0 to L minus 1. The relation between these three variants is depicted in the Venn diagram right side. Consequently, we prove that both IETF and the libpseudonym versions achieve SUFCMA security, namely strong unforgeability. Other than classical security notions such as unforgeability, the key substitution attacks also have great significance, especially in some specific realms, including digital currency and email authentication. Roughly speaking, the key substitution attacks aim to forge a new verification key or a new message that can pass the verification upon some real signatures. A digital signature scheme without resilience to key substitution attacks directly loses the non-repudiation property. That is, a user that has signed some message cannot at a later time deny having signed it. In our paper, we reintroduce three variants. The first one, strong universal exclusive ownership, requires the verification algorithm to output false upon a forged verification key that differs from the original one, a forged message and a honestly generated message signature pair. Moreover, we see a signature scheme has message bound signatures. If the verification algorithm cannot pass up on the same verification key and signature and the two distinct messages output by an adversary. Finally, the malicious strong universal exclusive ownership ensures that no adversary can forge two distinct verification key, VK and VK prime, a signature sigma, two messages M and M prime, such that the verification on VK M sigma and on VK prime M prime sigma both hold. In terms of the key substitution attacks, our first theorem reveals that all these three ED25519 variants have strong universal exclusive ownership. The analysis for message bound signatures is, however, not the case. An adversary can output verification key A, signature R, S, and two messages M and M prime, such that the points A and R both are on TED2519, and the positive S is less than L. Then pass the first and second checks. Additionally, the point A also has low order 8, which means 8 times A equals the point at infinity O, and further equals 0 times B, and that SB equals R. Then the third check also succeeds. Therefore, the adversary can win for arbitrary distinct messages M and M prime, which indicates that the IETF version does not have MBS. The Lipsodium variant prevents this attack by low-order point checking. In addition to bound checking, the Lipsodium version rejects the points A and R, which have order smaller than L. Now, we can easily find the differences between these three implementations. Compared to ED25519 original, the IETF and the Lipsodium versions involve bound checking. Namely, the IETF and the Lipsodium versions check whether the value S is in the range from 0 to L minus 1. Further, the Lipsodium version additionally involves low-order point checking. Namely, the Lipsodium version also checks whether the points A and R both have order greater than or equal L. The relation between these three variants is depicted in the Venn diagram right side. Consequently, we prove that the Lipsodium version has message bound signatures. Similarly, we also prove that it achieves malicious strong universal exclusive ownership. In the end, we would like to provide a summary for this talk. We compare the implementations of these three representative variants of ED25519. Besides, we disclose the different security guarantees achieved by these three variants, including unforgeability and resilience to key substitution attacks. Based on these conclusions, we recommend users to choose suitable variants according to their different purpose of usage, and to base their protocols on the suitable security assumptions of their underlying ED25519 variants. That is all of our talk. Thanks for your attention. If you are interested in the details of our work, please read our paper, The Probable Security of ED25519, Theory and Practice.